Good morning, everyone. My name is Maria Lucas. I'm the Communications Director for ATI. I'd like to thank you for joining us this morning for our webinar, Weather Patterns and Its Impact on Your Business. We have assembled a really great group of panelists today that are going to share their experiences and their expertise in the subject matter. But before I introduce them, I'd like to take care of just a couple of housekeeping items. You all have been muted just due to the number of participants, but we will be hosting a Q&A session at the end of the presentation. So please submit your written questions during the discussion that come to mind, and we'll get to them at the end of the session. So you can use your Q&A feature at the bottom of your Zoom window. So with that, I'm going to introduce our three panelists. Joining us today are Cameron Craig, Professor of Climatology at Eastern Illinois University, Noel Rodriguez, General Manager of Worth Ross Management, and Jerry Selak, Vice President, National Response Services for ATI Restoration. Cameron Craig is going to kick us off today to discuss the increase in extreme weather and how they lead to natural disasters. He's going to give us a little glimpse of what we can expect for 2021 and beyond, really. Cameron is a professor of climatology at Eastern Illinois University. He has received several awards for excellence in teaching, and in 2010 was honored with the title of Professor Laureate. Cameron has also leads the broadcast meteorology program, serves as chief meteorologist at the Emmy Award-winning TV station WEIU, and in all his spare time, he produces and directs documentaries. He's a very busy man, and we're really honored to have him here today as one of our panelists. Welcome, Cameron.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me. So to start out with the foundation of a warming climate, the big question is, what's the culprit? Well, carbon is the culprit that is causing climate change. And when you have a natural carbon release, for example, and ice, it falls, then it releases carbon into the atmosphere, into the environment, going back to basic just biology. Then we have a carbon emission amplified by human influences. In other words, when we want to build and we see a stand of trees, we cut that down and we slash them and we burn. And that magnifies the carbon introduction of carbon in the atmosphere. So that's the biggest problem. The culprit is carbon. Natural suppressors of a warming climate. Soil moisture helps moderate temperature. It's like if you sweat on your skin and it cools off, that helps to drop temperature of your skin. Soil moisture in the environment also reduces heating. But because you have an unbalanced heating increases evaporation. And so then there's less moisture in the soil. Vegetation also is an absorber of CO2. When you remove that vegetation, slash and burn, then you increase the CO2 in the environment. Now, this is one of the big questions that I get a lot from students and the general public is the battle between nature and humanity. The warming climate, it is a natural cycle. But humans are increasing the rate of warming via those activities I mentioned before, slash and burn, vegetation, and things that really cause problems. Now, what was really cool for this presentation is that NOAA released new normals a few weeks ago. And if you look at these 30-year periods, the 30-year average is considered to be the norm. And so when we take 30 years of data and we average them out, we have an average temperature, we have the 30-year precipitation. If you look at the start of the 1900s, it's coolish. And then as we continue each cycle, 30-year cycle, we get to the present year from 1991 to 2020, and it's warming. So what we use this normal data for is to compare. Is the temperature above normal or is it below normal? And so what we have a new data, we have a new cycle of 30-year data that we can use to analyze the temperature. All right, Maria, thank you. So some resulting factors of a warming climate. We have positive versus negative feedback situations. Now, the feedback here, positive doesn't mean good. In this case, negative feedback means that it is regulated or it is controlled. This is what we want. We don't want to have things get out of control. That's a positive feedback. A drought, for example, droughts are positive feedback because it rains and then that heat evaporates the moisture in the soil. And then you don't get any rain, so the temperature increases, positive feedback. Then when it does rain, that moisture coming back to the surface is actually going to be evaporated. So it's a positive feedback. The only way to get out of a drought situation is to either have a hurricane sit over your location, like the Midwest, that just dump enough moisture into the soil to reverse that. Turn it into a negative feedback situation. Another example, negative feedback would be something like mowing your lawn. When you mow it, you are controlling it. But if you let it out of control, the weeds grow, then critters start to move in, that's a positive feedback until something changes. Okay, so continental storms in the warm season and cold season, thunderstorm activity will increase. So drastic shifts in intensity and geography. We'll see more storms develop in places where it's not typical. Winter storm activity, you have more ice storms and debilitating snows. Now the hurricane frequency, we've seen it increase over the last 10 years. Last year, we had 31 tropical storms and 14 of them were hurricanes. Wildfire frequency increases with warming and drying. And this is where the humans have created the problem. Smoky Bear. Smoky Bear, it was great for the 1930s, but we have to let wildfires happen. They'd happen naturally because it cleanses the forest floor. And if you don't, if you suppress fire and don't let that forest to cleanse itself, then you have an increase in wildfire frequency and devastating too. You also have to have fire in order to get sequoia trees and redwood trees to pop their cones. The heat, the intense heat will allow for that cone to pop open and disperse its seed. Maria? So the big question or the big thing that we're talking about today is the polar vortex. Polar vortex, we've all heard it before, it's been in the news. It is actually the Arctic Oscillation. It's a climatological index of the Arctic Oscillation. The Arctic Oscillation shows us the strength of the jet stream in the middle part of the lower atmosphere. Now, generally, the jet is strong in winter because there's no sun in the northern hemisphere. It is weaker in summer because of the presence of the sun. And so what we want to have stronger jet stream in winter, and then it typically just becomes weak in summer. Now, a positive phase of the AO, or the Arctic Oscillation, strong jet stream, it bottles up the cold air. And then a negative phase AO, it's a weak jet stream. This is where we release the cold tongues of air to southern Texas or even to Florida. The reasons behind the polar vortex or the more that we're going to see, it's due to increased surface heating that will exacerbate the strength of the jet stream. So we will continue to see tongues of cold air thrust to the southern United States. Maria? So here's a graphic that I put together. The differences in phases of the polar vortex. Positive phase, you don't have many tongues of cold air or warm air. But in a negative phase of AO, you do have cold air that thrusts towards the equator. But at the same time, you also have tongues of warm air that move to the north. So while Texas was experiencing very cold temperatures, Alaska was actually warmer than the 48 states. Maria? So the recent event in that we're talking about, February 15, you see that tongue of cold air descending and essentially just straddling the Great Plains. The jet stream is indicated with the tight lines, the tight bold lines, and the trough of cold air reached the southern United States. And this can happen any time of the year. We've had cooler than normal temperatures this May for the eastern two-thirds of the United States. And that is part of the polar vortex. But it's more exciting to talk about in winter when you have temperatures in the negatives. And so, yeah, it's a neat phenomenon, Maria. So, perspective. The forecast of extremes, continued warming, we will see an increase in surface temperatures, and it will increase the extremes in weather events. The polar vortex negative phase will continue to be a problem for the southern states. Drought frequency will increase in duration and geography. For example, the Northwest United States usually gets a lot of rain. They can also experience more drought in the future. Hurricanes will be on the increase in frequency and geography, because as the warming planet, as the warmth starts to move northward, New England will see more hurricane activity. And then wildfires will increase in events and push to the east. We're seeing more and more red flag warnings being pushed eastward rather than sitting in the western half of the United States. Can this be reversed? There are people that ask me this question all the time. Climate is not a switch. We can't turn it off. So no, and the time has come and gone for reducing the effects of warming. James Hansen, the national climatologist, said in 2005 that we had 10 years to reduce our activity that's promoting climate change. That time has come and gone. So we must find a way to adapt to the extremes. Now, I was asked another question. What can we expect by 2050? And here's the big, this could happen. It could be more so. In 2010, temperature was 1.1 degree above the pre-industrial levels. What we will see by 2050 is a temperature rise near 3 degrees above pre-industrial levels. There will be 9% to 30% species extinction across the world. Arctic ecosystems will be damaged, non-repairable. And then all coral reefs will undergo bleaching. Essentially, they will die. And this comes from the IPCC.
Wow, that is not a very kind of a grim forecast, right?
Yeah, I'm sorry to bring such, dismal word, but yes, something that we have to concentrate on for the future.
Definitely something to be aware of and try to mitigate, right?
That's wow. Right.
With that, we are going to move on to discuss one of the kind of phenomenons that happened just recently this year, the polar vortex, and our next panelist, Noel Rodriguez with Worth Ross Management, is going to talk about the polar vortex impact on his property, the Metropolitan. So Noel is the general manager of the Metropolitan, which are luxury condominiums in Dallas, Texas. It opened in 2007, has about 281 units and almost 500 residents. Noel is responsible for the Association of Residents and Retail, which includes the maintenance of the property. In February, when the polar vortex freeze hit Dallas, his facility was greatly impacted, and he's going to share his story with us today. Thanks so much, Noel.
Thank you, Maria. First, let me say thank you to ATI for inviting me to speak today. It was an incredible storm that we went through, and I cannot be more thankful and excited about our new relationship that we established actually just weeks before the storm. So let me take you through the winter storm that had such a huge impact on our building. As we normally do, we're watching the weather conditions as it approaches the DFW area. Given the anticipated temperatures, we began to take the necessary steps to secure our building and to double check all of our systems, especially our water systems, such as our pool pumps, irrigation systems, and sprinkler systems, especially in the garage, which although in the garage there it's a dry system, it can still create moisture in those lines. Before I go any further, to give you a little history on the building, we're a 35-year-old building, which was converted to residential about 14 years ago. Worth Ross Management took over the building responsibilities on December 1st, 2017. One of the first things we did was to evaluate and implement a new preventative maintenance program. And despite the power outage, all our efforts paid off. Our systems were maintaining and the building continued to operate. So, which is what we wanted. Maybe if you could go to the next slide. So what happened? Let me tell you about the first morning after the initial temperature drop and what occurred once those temperatures started to impact the building. It was a beautiful morning. Snow was on the ground. It was fantastic. We don't get a lot of snow in Texas. So I was kind of enjoying it. But as I was driving up to work and approaching the building, I noticed water flowing from the garage onto the street. Fortunately, I had a couple of engineers who always get there early, and they were already in play, turning off water lines, getting things contained. But again, so what went wrong? All the buildings in the area had power. Well, what we didn't know was that during construction many years ago, they installed a simple toilet water supply line on an exterior wall. And unfortunately, the insulation that was installed was not sufficient for the unusual low temperatures that lasted for several days. And as a result, we had several of these water lines burst within the units. Three of the units were vacant. And so unfortunately, it was hours before anyone noticed the water. As you know, water will find its way down into many areas of the building. And for us, it made its way to an electric piece of equipment called a bus step that provides power to the upper half of our building, which includes all of my major mechanical equipment that sustains the building. So although the backup generator started, the major mechanicals were still offline. This actually started a ripple effect, causing a lot of the common areas, the hallways, lobby, to drop in temperatures, which really impacted our interior systems, such as our interior sprinkler lines, which is a wet system, unlike the garage, which is a dry system. So those started to freeze really quickly. Can we even go to the next slide? All right, so as you can see, all in a matter of a couple hours, we had several growing concerns starting to build. Fortunately, we had established a new relationship with ATI. I work for Worth Ross Management, and one of the incredible things that our corporate office offers us is what we call lunch and learns. We're given the opportunity to meet with leaders in a variety of industries, such as attorneys and contractors and insurance agents and tax professionals and just a wider range of leading industry leaders. Fortunately, just a few weeks before the winter storm, ATI had provided an amazing presentation, and I remember how impressed I was. As fate may have it, I still had the presentation material sitting on my desk. So I immediately called, and without hesitation, they jumped into action. Within a couple hours, I had two guys here from the corporate office. They were evaluating my building, getting information on how to navigate throughout the different areas, the loading dock. And as a formality, we went ahead and engaged our the ERA agreement, which is the emergency response agreement. That probably would have been done prior, but as I said, we had just met, right? So it was fantastic. But while this was taking place, the restoration team for ATI had already been dispatched. And within a couple hours, I had them on site. They took charge, they were organized, professional, they knew exactly what needed to be done, which as a general manager, that allows me to be focused on my residents and my staff and any other activities throughout the building. So I really appreciated that. The one thing I was really impressed was that at the end of each day, all the debris was gone. It was bagged up, taken away. We didn't have dumpsters sitting on the loading dock with, you know, old molding debris. It was seamless. It was all cleaned up with such an attention to detail. And then I started to receive daily reports on what had been accomplished. This allowed me to provide updates to my board of directors, my residents, the staff, and honestly, it gave me a great peace of mind as the general manager. So I appreciated that again. You know, as a general manager, it's so important that we create relationships that I know I can count on, and that provide a level of service that we're used to also providing. And throughout the entire process, I just truly felt that we were being taken care of at every point by ATI. They definitely lived up to their presentation, and I would even say they far exceeded it. So again, thank you guys. It was truly the best call I could have made that morning. You're already on here. So now where do we go from here? Well, throughout the storm, I started taking notes and started brainstorming on, you know, what could we have done to make improvements, or what could we do to make improvements to the building? And, you know, based on Cameron's presentation, I'm glad I did this, because I'm certain this type of storm is going to happen in the near future. So as the storm clears and we're able to take our breath, I began meeting with the engineers to get their perspective. And together we started to create a list of opportunities that I later called lessons learned. You know, I also wanted to get the board of directors and my residents' perspective. After all, they live in the building, so they actually had firsthand experience of the impact on their daily lives. So I needed to understand that as well. We also have an amazing group of general managers that for Worth Ross that are located in Dallas, Austin, and San Antonio, all areas that were impacted by the storm. So we all started sharing our experiences, which gave another interesting perspective from different regions, different areas. So what else? Well, since the storm brought such unusual temperatures, I then started thinking outside of Texas. Fortunately, we also manage a few properties in Colorado. So I reached out to our Vice President of Risk Management, Bob Mitchell, and we are currently gathering information from those properties. We're also going to look at some of the Denver building codes, see what we can learn from there. I am not an expert in building codes, so it may be a slow process, but nevertheless, I'm sure we're going to find some useful preventative maintenance recommendations that will help us move forward. In the meantime, we are just focused on getting our property back online, our homeowners back in their homes, and making a few modifications over the summer months that will have an immediate impact on our building in the event of a future storm. So again, I want to thank ATI for including me today, and thank you for your time and participation.
Thank you, Noel. I mean, what an experience for you. It feels like you were prepared, even though you were unprepared, right? You were prepared for the unexpected, which is an amazing position to be in when something like that happens. So I really appreciate you sharing your story, and hopefully other listeners are able to learn from your experience. And with that, I am gonna turn it over to Jerry Stelak, who is the Vice President of National Response Services for ATI. Jerry has 28 years of experience in the restoration industry and has been involved in over 30 national disaster events. Dating as far back as 2004. Jerry, you're dating yourself. He and the ATI National Response Services team work closely with our internal catastrophe team during major events such as hurricanes, wildfires, and of course, the recent polar vortex. They provide operational assistance and sales support with a focus on complex and large losses. So his team facilitates client communication, claim support, project coordination during the entire recovery process to streamline the process for the customer. So without further ado, Jerry, welcome.
Thank you, Maria. And Noelle, thank you for that kind of introduction. And it's exciting to hear, obviously, you know, with success stories from our clients. And it's really what drives us to be better and better on a daily basis. So thank you for that. So as we go through kind of really what to look for in a restoration partner, I want to ask everyone on this, you know, meeting to really ask yourself some questions. And when should you start planning for a natural or disaster response plan? And do you want a single source solution, or do you want multiple companies to be engaged? And what does that look like and why? What are some of the key performance indicators or KPIs that you require from your vendor? And how does that impact the process? And ultimately, how do different types of events impact all of the above? I think after we heard Cameron speak, we're all a little more concerned. No offense, Cameron, but it's definitely an eye opener, right? And so ideally, what does that look like for all of us moving forward? Next slide, Maria. So when do we start planning for disaster response and why? Well, the short answer is now. If you look at specifically Noel's example, had he not had that meeting prior, maybe he would not have had the ability of knowing who to go to at that time. Or certainly, given the polar vortex, what would have been his ability to bring a restoration partner or vendor in had he not had that meeting? A preferred vendor can equate to immediate deliverables, such as the case with Noel and his situation. Preparedness certainly equals productivity efficiency. And we'll get into a little bit about why that's so important and what that can do for your business or the property that you manage. Ultimately, that productivity efficiency will equal a reduction of loss exposure and potential business interruption. And all of the above, as we know, can reduce or minimize an increase in insurance premiums. We all know, based on climate change and what is transpiring across our nation, across the world, with more and more natural disasters, insurance premiums are on the rise. So the more prepared that we can be for our clients and the more prepared that you can be from having a restoration partner in place, can certainly help reduce and minimize those impacts. So do you want or should you use a single source solution and why? The long answer is yes. And I'd like to just bring up the difference between, and the reason why we stress here the word partner versus vendor. And the definition of vendor is a person or a company offering something for sale or as a service. But a partner or a partnership is a person or a company who shares or is associated with another in the same action or endeavor. And based on those two definitions, which would you rather have as you select that company moving forward? I think we'd all agree that you definitely want a partner. You want somebody that understands your business. And it goes back to that preparedness and, you know, equaling the productivity efficiency. When you have a partner that you've selected during the time of your greatest, during your greatest need, what does that look like? You know, that preparedness or that productivity efficiency, the reduction of loss exposure and potential business interruption insurance, whether that be a multifamily property where you have residents or tenants, whether it be a hospitality environment where you have guests, how does that restoration partner reduce the impacts on a day-to-day basis? Whether it's an institutional building where you have a school that's maybe been impacted by a tornado, how do you get your class and your teachers and your students back into class as quickly as possible? having that defined master service agreement or predetermined pricing schedule makes the entire process from ultimately cradle to grave go much more seamlessly and faster. Excuse me. When we talk about the vendor or the markets, meaning your insurance brokers and carriers, independents, independent adjusters and consultants, the more that those partnerships are formed into the greater depth, that it gives the entire claim execution, settlement, payments to you as the insured, it becomes so much faster of a process. And as I said earlier, really all of the above can equate to a reduction in market premiums moving forward as your loss ratio increases or as these natural disasters increase. How do we try to minimize that to you as the insured ultimately? What should you look for in a partner? Well, as Cameron, you know, basically stated that where wildfires used to be more prevalent in the Northwest, maybe that's now going to shift to the Central Plains and to the East Coast. So ultimately, you want to find a partner that mirrors your same or equivalent geographical coverage. Ideally, you want to find a company that overlays and their dots on a map really kind of overlay where your dots on a map. Mobilizing and response timing, that's ultimately the key, right? How do we minimize the impact? If your property or if your building is sustaining loss, how do we as a restoration company or another restoration company really get in and to try to minimize those impacts as that loss is occurring? You also want to identify in that partner what their resources look like from a labor standpoint, from equipment and supplies. Technical competence. You know, Noel brought this up in his presentation. How do we as a restoration partner share information, whether that be to you as the client, to the insurance company, insurance markets, to the consultants, making sure that your partner has the technical competence to be able to deliver communication and detailed information from daily field reporting to weekly field reporting. And what does that look like? The more knowledge and the more information that we can share with all parties during a claim, during an event, allows Noel from the management side to communicate with their tenants and their residents. It allows the insurance company to communicate with the markets. It allows the consultants to communicate with their insurance companies. That technical competence is really a key factor. And I think as we move forward in this industry, ultimately that's going to really what's going to be the differentiator between restoration companies. We at ATI use what's called a nerve center, and it's really identifying, it's a group of individuals within our organization that identify some of the key aspects for the specific client. So if we talk about a multifamily project, that project is going to be different and handled differently than a hospitality project is, or versus a industrial project or an institutional project. The goal of the restoration partner is to really identify what market segment that you as the client are in. And then the plan that any restoration partner should provide is how that detailed plan curtails to what market segment that ultimately we're trying to drive for you as the client. Safety protocols. I think we can all agree that over the past year in 2020 and going into 2021, everyone has had to change and shift safety protocols. Not only do we as a company have to identify safety protocols from a work standpoint, but over the last course of the last year and a half, what is all of us have had to do from a COVID standpoint? And how do we change and manipulate the safety protocol based on the environment that we're in? That is another key point to make sure that everyone is safe during and through this the event. And market support. What does that mean when I say market support? Really having preferred relationships with insurance companies, with consultants, with independent adjusters. Having their support is going to help us as a restoration company and you as a client or insured having a loss, really, again, continue to keep driving that claim forward in the most expeditious manner. Next, Maria. And really something that I'd like everyone to think about and take away is how do different disasters impact certain aspects of what we provide as a restoration company. So the way we look at it is when we talk about effective preparedness, we want to engage our clients in these disaster planning meetings, in disaster preparedness meetings. However, I think where we all at different times is try to take that plan and apply that plan across all aspects of all natural disasters. So just take for an example, as Cameron and his teams are determining a hurricane that's going to be making landfall to the United States, that is an easier event to prepare for and to get mobilized for than it is a tornado. It doesn't mean that we can't plan and prepare for a tornado, but we can certainly mobilize and be much more responsive and impactful gearing up for a hurricane than we can a tornado. Because I would look at it as this: a hurricane we can prepare for and we can be on the front end of it. Where a tornado, you're kind of almost on the back end. It's more of a response than it is a preparing. Same thing with a wildfire. We can identify areas where wildfires may have a higher frequency of occurring. But again, how do we service, or how does any restoration company service our client in a wildfire when we may be impeded in the getting into those areas because maybe that fire has passed your property, but we don't have the ability to get in? Flash flooding. When we look at flash flooding, again, it's generally due to a massive rain event. We can't necessarily prepare for that event specifically. We can certainly try to identify areas that are prone to flooding and have a plan based on that. But a lot of that's going to be reactionary. We talk about the polar vortex. Polar vortex was unique. Yes, we knew in preceding weeks that the temperatures were going to drop. But what I don't think anyone could have prepared for were the rolling blackouts that the state of Texas had to deal with. Those rolling blackouts contributed substantially and significantly to the amount of impacts and claims that the insurance industry and you as clients had. And earthquakes, same kind of thing. How do we can't necessarily prepare for where it's going to happen, but we can have certain dialogue and certain plans in place of that. And then really, how do we support that from both the client and employee support? When we look at a flood or a polar vortex, I can tell you personally, from an ATI perspective, we did have employees that suffered losses at their homes as related to the polar vortex. As clients, Noelle could have had a potential loss at his house, right? So what does that look like not only for the client, but how do we also make sure that we support the employees of our clients? What are those events and different types of disasters have on our vendors and the response and the mobilization? Again, the logistics and the resources, and how do those different events? So I think, and ultimately then also the specialty contractors and vendors. I think the takeaway from this is we have to prepare. We know that these disasters are going to continue to keep happening. And based on what Cameron said, the frequency, the severity is only going to continue to get worse. And what do we do? We can't just have a blanket plan. We have to kind of plan now moving forward that each one of these disasters can impact our regions differently on a more frequent basis. Thank you, Maria.
Thank you so much, Jerry. Great information from all three panelists. And now we're going to just address any questions that you all may have. We're going to start with one, which actually is a great question directed to Cameron, I think. So Cameron, what, in your opinion, is the best state to retire in as far as weather is concerned outside of California? Apparently, this person lives in California and is considering retiring elsewhere.
Well, Canada is the best.
Interesting.
It's interesting that students do ask that question as well. And I go back to another point, and that is, where is the breadbasket of the world? Well, it's the United States. As warming will continue, it will be Canada. And it will also be Siberia because of the permafrost is unlocking. The permafrost is melting. And so it's unlocking very fertile land. So my answer to that, the best location, I tell my students, Canada is going to be a beautiful place to live. Not too hot and not too cold.
Wow. And as a follow-up, just out of my curiosity, how far down the line would you say, like in 10 years, 20 years, or?
I believe we're looking 30 years.
In 30 years.
Water okay. will be a problem. If you participate as a student in my classes, I give a 3-day lecture on water resources. And water will be a major problem that we will all have to deal with, because in some places it will be there, and in other places it will not be.
Wow. It's kind of great.
Bringer of wonderful news.
Yes, you are. I mean, I think of my children, as I'm sure many people on this call are, you know, what will they have to deal with, you know, in the future? So, okay. Another question just came through. Are storms like the Derecho we have had? Dercio, devastate Iowa last August, still cleaning up on the list of events that may become more frequent?
Yes, we will see more of Dercios occurring in the Midwest and further up north too. There will also be what we call MCS, which is a mesoscale convective complex or system. Those are storm systems that develop overnight. And Iowa is centrally located. I mean, storms develop in Iowa, and then they take forever to move east. And those are the MCSs. We'll see more of those frequent.
Okay. So another one, will our seasons ever return to normal, Cameron?
Will our seasons return to normal? Probably not. Probably not. We're starting to see a diminish in our fall and also our spring. And then the summers will be much longer, and then winter much shorter, much, much shorter. It's interesting that, I did my master's thesis was reconstructing Indiana's climate of the 19th century using personal journals and diaries. And it's interesting to read what people had to say about the weather then. And in the mid-1800s, we're looking at the weather descriptors that were used. There were very, very long winters, extremely long winters, and very short summers, temperature-wise. Now we're seeing a complete reverse.
So, and do you see that worldwide?
Yes.
Or you're just referring to the worldwide?
Worldwide.
Okay, interesting. Okay, Cameron, how has technology advanced over recent years?
The models are getting much better because now there are more scientists putting their hands and their ideas into what the atmosphere is doing. So the modeling system is much better, much improved. We also have better technology in looking at the Earth. So satellite technology is getting better. LIDAR, the use of laser, to identify clouds and the such, that is becoming bigger, and more investments are being used in that respect. So, and then another one, we have more people that are participating as observers. We have a station at the university, And my students go every day, rain, shine, holidays at 6 p.m. every day and collect data for National Weather Service. And then that's where the normal information comes from, are those stations that are scattered throughout the United States.
Interesting. I have a question here for Noelle. It says, you know, what types and how many different types, I should say, of fire sprinklers should there be or could there be in a high-rise building? And really, you know, how does it affect kind of what happened, you know, in your particular building?
Thank you, well, I think I mentioned a couple of them in my presentation. One is our a wet system. You'll typically find that in the insides of most high rises. And what that is, it's called a wet system because there's constant water flowing through these pipes. So when a fire occurs, water is immediately sent out, right? In a dry system, which you typically find in a garage, open air garage or a big warehouse, where heating isn't possible, then you have a dry system. And what that is, those pipes are constantly being pressurized by air. And when a fire is detected, it releases the air first and then the water fills the pipes. So in those areas, in the dry systems, you find those in those areas because the temperatures can obviously drop and those pipes would easily freeze. Now moisture can still gather in those. So we have to go drain them. And that's through a system called a drip drum, which we have numerous of those throughout our garage areas so that we make sure that all that moisture is taken out to prevent pipes freezing. So very, very important preventative maintenance.
Wow, good information for everyone to know. Jerry, question for you. Does ATI have any planning or PE for residential insurance repair?
PE. So planning, we absolutely do. And when you, maybe if somebody can clarify the question on the planning for residential repair.
Residential insurance repair. Does ATI have any planning for residential? And then in parentheses, he put PE, residential, for residential insurance repair.
I mean, yes, we absolutely do, Maria. A lot of what we've done, you know, even during the polar vortex down in Texas, you know, we have done and are still continuing to do residential work, both on the mitigation and emergency services. So, you know, not just commercial and my national team, but a lot of what we do in ATI is based on the residential market and residential insurance space. Absolutely.
Great. Okay, and I'm gonna end it with this one last question. So direct it to Cameron. Cameron, what will be the end result of our warming planet? What do you see?
Are you willing to pay $25 a pound for beef? Are you willing to pay $150 for a jar of preserves? These are things that were in this movie Soylent Green, and some of us may remember that film. That took place in 2022, so we still got some time. But the problem is we're going to have to pay more for the things that we're used to getting every day. So that's the end result. And here's one more thing. Ask yourself, who is more adaptable to a warming climate? Is it the more developed countries or the less developed countries? I ask this of my students and I always get, well, we have the technology, so it'll be us. But ask yourself, when it's the air conditioning, if it's hot outside, you want it down to 68 in winter, you want to raise that up to 72. We have luxuries like that. In other less developed countries, you do not have those luxuries. And so those will be the people that adapt to a warming climate. So we need to think differently about the water that we use and what will happen to us in the future. How are we going to adapt?
It's a great comment, great food for thought, and amazing information. So I'm going to leave this screen up for just a quick minute. If you want to look interested in learning more about the topics discussed, please feel free to reach out directly to our panelists. We're also obviously recording this webinar, and it will be available for you to rewatch or share with members of your team. We will be posting it up on our website and also sharing it out through email. So thank you again for joining us. Thank you to our panelists, and have a wonderful day.